Good morning, and welcome to Peakland United Methodist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia. My name is John Vest. I'm one of the ministers here at Peakland Church, and this is our online worship for Sunday, May 10, 2020. It's Mother's Day, so we hope all of our mothers will have a happy day today. Also want you to notice our worship table. We're very grateful to Jan Hickey. She is the chair of our worship committee, and she worked very hard to prepare this for us, so thank you, Jan. I will be today's preacher. Our liturgist is Emma Johnston. We have three musicians. Noemi Lee has a recording from her home. Lynn Nash, a flugelhorn player, is recording from Hickory, North Carolina. And Linwood Campbell, our director of worship and outreach, will be playing keyboard. Let us begin with our call to worship.
Friends, would you join me in our call to worship? The Lord requires three things of us: to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with God. Do this, and God's blessing will abound. Teach us your ways, O God. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Today, for our time with the children, I want to talk to you about oatmeal. Now, when I was a child, my mom, on cold winter days or on those rainy mornings, would make a big pot of oatmeal and we would all sit together and eat. So now, one of my favorite breakfast foods is oatmeal. I have it every single day. So, kids, my challenge to you is to tell your mom what makes her so special to you. What are those things that you love about her? What are some of your favorite memories together? Maybe it involves food. Maybe it involves a vacation. Maybe it's how she is helping you to do your schoolwork while we're all stuck at home. So friends, that is my challenge to you today. Let us pray. Holy and loving God, we give thanks for our mothers and those motherly figures in our lives. Help us to show them how special they are to us, and help us to love like they love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, as we enter into a time of prayer with one another, we like to lift up one of our homebound members, and this week we lift up Doris Connor. Would you join me in prayer? Holy God, your blessings are abundant, and your wisdom exceeds our grasp. Fill us with your Spirit so that we might catch a glimpse of life as you want it to be. Search us and know us. With that knowledge, teach me how to hold on and to let go. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This day we gather with eager hearts, hungry for your word, yearning for the joy you promise in love. God, together we hold a vision of your kingdom, a people of prayer and open hearts, a loving body of Christ eager to learn and eager to share. You bless us, O God, and shine upon us with the mercy of your salvation. And your good earth has yielded its increase through those who have brought us great blessing. On this day of celebrating your love, we lift to you those who have given us life, those who have loved us, those who have blessed us, and those who have taught us, our mothers. May your blessing pour out upon the woman who gave us birth, and those beautiful, strong women of faith who have been mothers to us along our journey. We praise you, O God, for your gift of motherly love, both gentle and fierce, both strong and humble, both kind and true. Where we have been so blessed, we give our grateful praise, for you have provided loving hands that have worked so hard in raising us, cared enough to correct us, blessed us in ways we cannot have fully known as children. We call forth your compassion upon every mom who has unknowingly caused pain and suffering. And so we lift to you our mothers, so imperfect, also so wounded by this world. We bless our mothers this day, no matter what they have done or left undone. We do this because we believe in your healing, we believe in your love, and we believe that you love every mother, good or bad, and we stand together with all mothers in solidarity, for we are all in need of your grace. Where we have failed because we did not know better, help us to forgive ourselves. Where we have seen your face in any woman who has been to us a mother, in her face we have seen your light and your love, and we give thanks. For where they have loved, they have kept your word and blessed us. We lift to you our Mother Earth. We lift to you our Mother Church. We lift to you, O God, your mother's heart. And although we cannot fully express our gratitude, help each one of us to be your blessing of love, a blessing straight from your heart. Amen. Friends, every week we like to let you know how we have been in ministry with one another. This week, we celebrate our Disciple Bible Study class, which came to a close after 6 months of very hard work. Let us pray. Loving God, thank you for the sense of purpose and hope we see in all who believe and trust in you. In response to the generosity of your love, may this act of worship be equally generous in the ways of gifts, tithes, and service. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
The Sermon on the Mount can be found in two places in the New Testament, in Matthew's Gospel and in Luke's Gospel. Matthew's Gospel is the longer version of it. It starts with the Beatitudes. That's our text for today, and it begins with chapter 5. Let us hear these words. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are you, when men revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account, rejoice, be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so men persecuted the prophets who were before you. Let us bow together in prayer. Holy and loving God, out of all the words that are being spoken and heard this day, may it be your living word that stays with us. And by your grace and mercy, help us to let go of all those other words. This I pray in Christ's holy name. Amen. It looks like we're going to continue to worship this way for at least another month or so. And that gets us into some difficult and creative opportunities to be the church in worship. We are starting to have conversations about how to recognize our graduates, how to celebrate Pentecost Sunday, how to celebrate Confirmation Sunday, which normally includes water baptism and the laying on of hands. And today, this Mother's Day, how do we do that? There's no argument to be made that worship is first and foremost about God, but Mother's Day was actually started by a Methodist laywoman. We may call God Father, but will you deny the truth that God loves us also with the passion and the best that we call Mother? Back in February, Emma preached a wonderful sermon on these Beatitudes, which is the text I've chosen for the day. In her sermon, Emma said two things that have stayed with me. First is how she described certain places, certain moments with God as thin. It's what it feels like when the veil between heaven and earth is but a breath away from one another, she said. I think for some of us, it was our mothers who first pointed us toward that thin space. And Emma quoted Rob Bell about the power of gospel. The power not just of the gospel, which is the good news of Jesus Christ, but the power of gospel itself, of good news that is also life news. Gospel, Bell said, is the shocking, provocative, revolutionary, subversive, counterintuitive good news that in your moments of greatest despair, failure, sin, weakness, losing, failing, frustration, inability, helplessness, wandering, and falling short, God meets you there. Right there. Right exactly there. In that place, I would add that thin place, and announces, I am on your side. I am on your side. Sometimes, I think when we think of the best that a mother can be, it really comes down to that. She's on your side. And when I consider the motherhood of God, I think it comes down to that, as expressed in the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes, this beginning of what has come to be called the Sermon on the Mount, is important, and we know it before a single word is spoken. When Jesus saw the crowd, Matthew tells us, he went up to the mountain and sat down. and his disciples came to him. In our culture, when an important figure wants to make an important statement, he or she stands up. In the debate, we stand in opposition. When the United Methodist men say grace over the weekly Saturday morning breakfast, we do so standing up. It's a sign of respect, an act that immediately says, stop what you're doing and focus. What is about to happen is important. Well, in the tradition of Jesus' day, when a rabbi wanted to convey truth, he would sit down. Casual conversations took place on one's feet. Disciples' questions could be answered. Passerby could be brought into the conversation while walking through the market or standing under a shade tree at the heat of day. Usually, the agenda, the classroom, was controlled by the questioners. But when a teacher decided it was time for something new to be shared, a deeper understanding to be engaged, he sat down, and everyone would know this is important. So Jesus sat down, and he said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom. And then he added, blessed are you. When people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account, rejoice and be glad, for your reward is in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. In times of trouble, I like to pull out a beatitude or two for the strength I find there. When my spirit is troubled and weak, blessed are the poor in spirit. When my heart is broken, blessed are those who mourn. When an act of kindness is thrown back into your face, blessed are the merciful. When words are hurled like daggers and spears, blessed are those who are persecuted. But, there may be a better way to look at the Beatitudes. Instead of each Beatitude accepted as a specific guidance for specific situations, what if we took them all together? What if we read the Beatitudes as a whole, as a way of life? Would such a way of living change the world as we know it? Suppose we were to question the assumptions the world makes about itself, how some companies do business, their business model, how healthcare bills are handled in collection, the assumptions of SOLs in school, how love and dating and attraction are expressed in the entertainment industry. Aren't you already doing some of this? I know I have reached the age where instead of bopping down the road with the top down in the car, the wind in my hair, and the radio blaring, when traffic gets confusing, I have to turn off the radio because it somehow does help me to see better. Haven't you ever talked back to the faceless voice on the radio that has said something so contrary to the way you believe things are supposed to be that you've given that radio a good piece of your mind? Well, let's go a step further. Suppose the underlying premise about these Beatitudes is to have us question the assumptions we make about ourselves and the world we have created for ourselves. I read once that Christianity is just training in how to pay attention. Pay attention, now that's a mother's phrase, don't you think? Of course, there's more to our faith than that, but as a preacher whose job is to encourage all of us to engage life theologically, that is, in conversation with God, I do find a statement like that to be intriguing. So Jesus begins the Sermon on the Mount by sitting down. His disciples gather, and they consider the assumptions they have been making about life. They start to pay attention. Blessed are those who have their acts together. No. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who get up most mornings full of life and ready to go. No. Blessed are those who get up in the morning and mourn. Blessed are the gurus and pod pipers of leadership seminars. Of course not. Blessed are the meek who know they need something. Blessed are those with degrees who teach and preach. Of course not. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst. Blessed are those who take charge and get things done. No, it's better to be merciful. Blessed are those who dress well, smell pretty, drive nice cars, have fat, fast-track portfolios. No. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are those who take no prisoners in politics, who tell it like it is. I think we need some peacemakers. Blessed are those who don't take lip off of anybody. No. Blessed are those who are persecuted. It would appear that God has a thing or two for those of us who don't usually garner respect or admiration, about the people who don't have the looks or the lifestyle or the business acumen to participate in most of the commercials we see depicted as success. It appears, for those who fairly often feel like you just don't fit in, God is on your side. So, what are we going to do? What are we going to do with these Beatitudes? Maybe that's not the right question. Not the right question at all. Instead of asking, what are we supposed to do with them, a better question just might be, what are these teachings of Jesus supposed to do with us? How will they push us off our comfortable perch from which we survey our kingdom? How will they challenge the assumptions around which we have built our lives? How can this way of looking at the world change the way we look at the world? Indeed, what do these eight sayings of Jesus tell us about the way God looks at the world? In the later years of his life, the great composer Beethoven would spend hours playing a broken harpsichord. The instrument was practically worthless. Keys were missing, strings were stretched, jacks were broken. It was out of tune, harsh on the ear, and had few redeeming qualities. Nonetheless, the great pianist would play until tears cascaded down his cheeks. You may know that in a cruel twist of fate, Beethoven became deaf in his later years. Not merely hard of hearing, but completely deaf. He was known to lay his head on the top of the instrument as he played so he could at least feel the vibrations of the music. And I share this with you because I think these Beatitudes speak to the heartfelt and spirit-filled vibrations of life. Those vibrations that come when we sense that God is on our side. Sometimes we do need to turn a deaf ear to the noise of the world in order to feel the resonance of the presence of God in our souls. The writer, Max Lucado, tells of a time when he had stayed at home to play with the family. They played every game they knew, running, hide-and-seek, beach ball, wrestling, all of them. They got so caught up in family life, the bedtime hours were ignored, the TV was turned off, and if a storm had not rolled in, who knows how long they would have played together. But the storm did come. Rain slapped against the windows, wind blew against the shutters with such fury that there was nothing more appropriate to do that night than to share the same bed. Father, daughter, mother, all crowded together. And then it happened. And Lucado writes, "I sensed it as we were lying in bed. It blew over me, mixed with the sweet fragrance of fresh rain. My wife was lying silently at my side. Jenna was using my stomach for her pillow. She too was quiet. Our second child, only a month from birth, rested within the womb of her mother. They must have sensed it, for no one spoke. It entered our presence as if introduced by God himself, and no one dared stir for fear it leave prematurely. What was it? An eternal instant. An instant in time that had no time. A picture that froze in mid-frame, demanding to be savored. A minute that refused to die after 60 seconds. A moment that was lifted off the timeline and amplified into a forever so all the angels could witness its majesty." An eternal instant. That's what the Beatitudes call us to. If we can see the world just for a moment as God sees the world, if we can see one another and care for one another with the same compassion, the same passion, the same grace which the Creator of life has for us, if we would give ourselves over just for a moment to the idea that God is on our side. Could you? Could you be the same again? A moment of commitment really does have the power to turn your world upside down. So friends, beloved of God, happy Mother's Day. May you be blessed this day, and may you be a blessing. Amen. Thank you.
Would you join with me in our commission and blessing? There is a spirit to the Beatitudes. Let us commit our lives to discovering the blessings of God. May Christ, the light of God's love, shine brightly on your path. And may we seek to be a blessing to others. Amen.